Joy Belmonte gets a second term as she is proclaimed the winner of Quezon City's mayoral race. She joins us this morning. Mayor Joy Belmonte, welcome back to Head Start.
Karen, hello. Good morning.
All right. Well, first of all, congratulations are in order. Congratulations to you. You did win over Congressman Mike Defensor with over a lead of 300,000 votes. This is correct?
I think it's a little less than that, something like 250,000.
Okay.
Last time, yeah.
That's a pretty big lead. That's a pretty big lead. And let's first talk about the last campaign. I mean, I would have to say that this was one of the toughest and between rivals, one of the most bitter races that media people have seen, right? And what was that like for you?
Well, it was, I think, more psychologically damaging than anything else because I always trust data. So I always have surveys, no? And I have surveys from various sources. So I could see that I was performing well. But then the constant barrage and attack on my person, some of them very personal, some of them very below the belt, some of them very attacking my gender, attacking my things that you don't usually bring up in an election campaign, because you usually talk about your platforms, your performance, your track record, why people should vote for you. But it got pretty messy. And I think the real challenge was to try to stay above this kind of campaign strategy and still do campaign in the level that I felt the people of Quezon City deserved.
Uh-oh. Now, the other thing that's been challenging for many candidates, including yourself, was social media. The platform of social media was used really by many candidates and sadly using negative spin or spreading disinformation. So you actually filed a cyber libel charges against Mr. Defensor. And I wanted to ask you, does this mean now that you've won, you're going to drop the charges?
I don't think it's beyond, it's no longer in my capacity to drop the charges because we've already filed them in the necessary venues. And I think after that, they have an independence of their own. And so you can't anymore drop the charges. That's my understanding. They are being pursued now in the proper forum.
Okay. Now, one of the issues that Mr. Defensor actually accused you with is what he called alleged overpriced ayuda. So I wanted to ask you, now that you've won a second term, how will you ensure that people around you don't take advantage of, I mean, ang ayuda kasi binibigay na ng bawat LGU ngayon eh. Don't take advantage of this particular accusation that he's actually made.
Well, actually, Karen, the Commission on Audit was requested by Mr. Defensor during their budget hearing in Congress to review our clean opinion on the basis of this overpriced ayuda. And the technical review came back reiterating that there was no overpricing in the ayuda. That's one. And then second, I think he used two individuals, not himself, but one NGO and one alleged disgruntled employee to file plunder cases against me. But these have been dropped by the ombudsman. They did not even reach the level of asking me to explain. They were just dropped. You know, so these for me are a testament that there was no overpricing that occurred. What he did was deceive the public because the public are not familiar with the bidding process here in the city, how we procure. No? So obviously the price in pure gold will not be the same as the price when you procure here. For many reasons, you're procuring millions of items, there's storage, there's transportation, there's labor, there's repacking, there's taxes, and obviously you're buying on credit. You're not paying right away. The supplier has to wait several months to get their payment. There's the cost of money. And Mr. Defensor, what he did was he went to Pure Gold, got the items, and then said, here are the prices, and this should be the prices. Then he calculated based on the prices on the supermarket. But that is, for me, deception already on his part, because he has served in government. So he understands very well the procurement process here. So for me, that was quite malicious. It is not about the people around me being dishonest. It is about a man being malicious and looking, taking advantage of maybe the lack of knowledge of the people with regards to government processes.
Okay. Now, during your last term, 2 years of your term was actually dealing with a pandemic. And most of the local government's units, of course, face the same challenge, right? It's either you did well during the pandemic or you didn't do well at all. So you either fall into those two categories. But what will a Belmonte leadership in Quezon City be post-pandemic and pandemic recovery? What are your priorities?
Well, first, Karen, I would like to stress good governance now, because I was very happy when I found out that, you know, during the pandemic year of 2020, we actually collected the most local revenue in the history of Quezon City, despite the fact that 10,000 businesses closed. And for me, that was surprising. This was about 22 billion, and we've never raised that much money, or we've never collected that much revenue locally, you know. And that shows that with the good governance mechanisms intact, or in place, it is possible really to generate revenue for the city that can address the needs of the city. And so I will continue with good governance now, because that really helps. What is good governance? You really become strict with regards to filing cases against caring officials of the city. You ensure that business owners pay the right taxes as well. You know, these kinds of things. You don't tolerate, you know, yung negotiating or the usual practices that government is known for. That's one. So when you have enough funds, I think that you can now implement good projects or programs for recovery. And one of the programs that we implemented that I find very successful was our Pangkabuhayan Quezon City program, wherein we pumped in about 250 million pesos for small entrepreneurs to start their own micro businesses, together with training and the help of the DTI at GCash and other private sector agencies. And we were able to help 25,000 people who had no sources of income have small businesses. And this was validated when I went around during my house-to-house sorties. Many people were thanking me for that opportunity, and they were showing me their businesses. So that was one very effective strategy. The second is to help our small to medium enterprises. So we have a program called Kalingang QC, which helped businesses that were on the brink of collapse or bankruptcy, help them to, to sustain their businesses by subsidizing the salaries of their employees, or pumping in some, subsidies into their businesses just to prevent these businesses from closing down. And we were able to help thousands of businesses stay open. And then, of course, there is my program on food security. I realized that during the pandemic, food was a problem for many poor people, especially when all the mayors were procuring the lata, you know, and then you didn't have enough. So now we have more than several hundred urban farms that we have established in the last 2 years, just to help us at least ensure that there is a sufficient supply of food for our people in a time of need. You know? So these are just some of the things we're doing.
I'm curious, Mayor Belmonte, will the Mandanas ruling dramatically affect Quezon City in any way?
I was hoping that it would, Karen, because that would mean more funds for us here. But then I was in talks with, I think, the statistics office, because based on their census of our population did not grow in the last 5 or 6 years. It grew by maybe 13,000 people. I find that unrealistic. And therefore, based on that minimal growth, the amount of money that we were expecting to be received by the city government was is a little bit low compared to what I think our real population is. So I've requested a review of this census.
Now, speaking of the population, now that you're on your second term, is there any way, I mean, clearly on a national scale, the national ID system is in its baby steps, so to speak, right? But in Quezon City, is there a way for you to actually have your own ID system? I mean, of course, attached to the national ID system, so you know how many residents you really have in Quezon City.
Yes, we already have our own ID system. Karen, we started it last year, and it's the Quezon City ID. And this is for all residents of Quezon City. You know? So far, we are, because it's also not just an ID, but also attached to service delivery. So if you have an ID with a QR code, you can, for example, get into our bus for free. You can we can record how many times you've received, let's say, your free maintenance medicines. We can record how many times you've received certain services from the city. So this ID is not just an identification card, but it also helps us track how much services a certain individual, family, or group have received from the city. And that will enable us also to distribute our resources more equitably so that truly we can say that all people are being benefited by the taxpayers' money. No, so that's the purpose of this idea, aside from keeping track of our population.
Okay, now before we go, I can't ignore this particular issue because it's in the Inquirer, Manila Bulletin, Manila Times. Maybe you can comment on this and set the record straight. It says that Quezon City disallowed the Robredo Thanksgiving event for supporters. So what is it? Did you really reject the permit?
Karen, let me just explain that there are rumors spreading that we had granted the permit and then this was revoked. No, that's not true. What we did receive was a letter requesting the use of the Liwasang Aurora in the Quezon Memorial Circle just a couple of days ago. Now, prior in the protocols in Quezon City is prior to approving a rally permit, we have to have a coordinating meeting with the organizers. And we have to agree on all fronts as to how certain problems that might ensue should be resolved. In this case, the meeting only took place yesterday, that coordinating meeting only took place yesterday. So it seems as if the Robredo camp had spread already or disseminated that the rally would take place in the Liwasang Aurora even before the permit had actually been issued. So during the coordinating meeting, it came out that a big crowd was expected. No? And they could not actually tell us what the size was, but they said the size was expected to be very large. Now, this is payday Friday. The rally was going to be at 5 o'clock in the afternoon, rush hour. Many of the people in Quezon City are commuters, and Commonwealth Avenue is, of course, the main thoroughfare adjacent to the Quezon Memorial Circle. And it is already on a regular work day, a jam-packed thoroughfare. No? So given these factors, and then the lack also of time to come up with a proper traffic management plan, and also knowing that many of the Robredo supporters drive their own cars, they belong to the EB Upper C, we expected massive traffic. But we talked to them and said, maybe you might have a different, I would say, venue in mind, because we are very afraid for our commuters. No? This usual traffic problem is something that I'm still grappling with to this day. And I didn't want to add to that.
I wanted to ask you, Mayor Belmonte, is it also a factor that the campaign season is over? I mean, I just wanted to ask the mayor, that's not a factor? For any mayor?
No, that is not a factor. It was really just traffic. And then I would like to stress that the organizers in the city government mutually agreed that, yes, this is a serious problem. We could not really think of a acceptable solution. And then when we asked them, do you have an alternative venue? They did point out that the Ateneo was an alternative venue for them. And we did suggest maybe you might want to do it at the Ateneo, and then we will provide you traffic support there rather than in the circle, which is close to our major thoroughfares. And that is what happened. But I don't know why, because during the discussion, it was very clear that our messaging would be complementary. And that this is our message, this is your message. We even shared messages with each other. So that to make sure to avoid fake news, to avoid marites, to avoid, you know, all kinds of malicious interpretations, but they still happen. So I'm grateful that you gave me this chance to explain what really happened. Yeah.
Now, on that note, my last question is, you have 31 million Filipinos voting for a Marcos Duterte presidency, but let's talk about Mr. Marcos. I mean, your father's history first. He was with the Liberal Party, worked closely with former President Aquino. I'm curious, now that you're mayor, perhaps how does this affect you, your leadership, and what kind of leadership would you want to see from Mr. Marcos?
Well, Karen, you know, I would like to be very open-minded about this issue because the people of the Philippines have spoken and I do not want to pass any kind of judgment. I would like to be open and I would like to feel and believe that there is hope given that there is such a large majority supporting Mr. Marcos, and therefore Mr. Marcos will feel that this mandate will probably encourage him to really perform to the best of his ability to uplift the lives of these 31 million people that are now depending on him to improve their lives. So at this stage, I would just like to say, I would like to just be supportive at the moment because I have not seen, I suppose the programs he would like to put in place. I've not seen them, I've not examined them. I would like to support at this moment. But of course, as with any president, I always encourage the people of Quezon City to remain vigilant. Because that is our duty as citizens.
All right. Well, Quezon City Mayor Joy Belmonte, congratulations to you and good luck on your second term.
Thank you very much, Karen, and thank you for having me at your show. Thank you.